Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Good morning across the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide, the Civic Media app. I'm Todd Albaugh. Along Mr. Aaron Zommer, our producer and engineer, it is Wednesday, April 26, 2023. Welcome into hour number two. Always great to have Mr. Trygve Olsen along for a Wednesday. Very informative, right? Always get a little insight there, whether it's a personal insight or political insight.
Oh, yeah. Or sports insight, since, of course, he is an NFL owner.
Yes, absolutely he is. So we appreciate Trygve, as always. He'll be back with us next Wednesday, as per usual, in the 8 o'clock hour. Also, thanks to Pat Kreitlow of Up North News on Civic Media every day from 6 until 8 a.m. across the Civic Media Radio Network, with the exception of WRCE in Richland Center, where it is sunrise from the center. With Phil Nee and a cast of characters, including Henry Bray and also Joanne Krulot. So give them a listen, 6 until 8 on WRCE in Richland Center. You can listen to them on the Civic Media app via WRCE, or you can also listen to Pat Kreitlow as well on the Civic Media app via Bull Falls Radio, or also the Madison station, WMDX, here in Madison. Pat Kreitlow, Up North News, Phil Nee, and Sunrise in the Center, two great programs, 6 until 8, every day across the Civic Media Radio Network. It is 7 minutes past the hour of 9 o'clock. Let's take a look at some weather and news headlines for this April 26th, the Wednesday, 2023. In Richland Center today, news from the center, WRCE, increasing clouds today, a high of 54 degrees. Then for tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 35. Tomorrow, Thursday, mostly sunny, beautiful day on tap. Kara Foster says today and tomorrow are the days to get out and enjoy it, a high of 66 degrees. In Richland Center tomorrow, and probably most likely not much wind at all. Pretty calm skies. Thursday night, increasing clouds, a low of 40. And then on Friday, the rain moves in, a high of 65 on Friday, but temperatures will be falling throughout the day. It's going to get cooler, much cooler, over the weekend. Up in Wausau, Bull Falls Radio, WXCO, patchy fog this morning. Then mostly sunny in the afternoon today, a high of 52 degrees. For tonight, cloudy, a chance of showers, and 39 for a low. Tomorrow, and 61, a chance of showers up in Wausau for tomorrow. Over in Amory, WLAK, Lake Air Radio Land, mostly sunny today, a high of 53. Tonight, scattered showers, breezy, a low of 43. And tomorrow, Thursday, scattered showers and a high of 59. Again, temperatures will be falling across the state, getting cloudy and drizzly throughout most of the weekend. So overall, today is the best day for everyone in the state to get out and enjoy the great weather. Richland Center will have some decent weather yet tomorrow, at least, before the colder temperatures move in. Wherever you're at, get out and enjoy it, and enjoy the sunshine before the clouds move in. It looks like long-term, not this coming weekend, but the following weekend, finally some higher temperatures move in once again. Taking a look at the news headlines for you, a growing list of companies are announcing layoffs this year and concerns about economic uncertainty, as well as the need to cut back after going on a hiring spree during the pandemic. Disney, BuzzFeed, Lyft, and Deloitte are among the list of major companies that have reduced their workforce this year. The tech sector has also been hit hard over the past few months following mass layoffs in 2022. Amazon, Meta, meaning Facebook, Microsoft, and PayPal have also axed thousands of employees and warned additional cuts may be on the way. This comes as first-time claims for unemployment rose to 245,000 last week, above expectations of 240,000, according to data from the Department of Labor. Employers also added 236,000 jobs in March, falling below expectations, signaling that the Federal Reserve's year-long rate hiking campaign to chill inflation is now also cooling the labor market. I also think it's important to put a little context in here, all right? A lot of these firms that we talked about here, BuzzFeed, Lyft, Meta, Amazon, Microsoft, PayPal, part of the reason they went on a hiring spree is because most of those companies revolve around things that we do at home. And so during the pandemic, a lot of folks were working remotely, working at home. And so, you know, a lot more Amazon was going on, deliveries at home, a lot more people at home on Facebook and Meta, watching Disney Plus, taking Lyft, those sorts of things. So now that the pandemic is on the downside, a lot of companies are requiring people to go back to work in person, back in the building. And so many of these companies that were focused on at-home services are laying people off. So I just want to put that in proper context, that there's a reason that our society is shifting back to slightly less working at home and more in person. Making national headlines, Washington's Democratic Governor Jay Inslee on Tuesday signed a statewide ban on most sales of assault-style weapons. House Bill 1240 prohibits the manufacture, importation, distribution, and sale of assault-style weapons in the state, with an exception for sales made to armed forces and law enforcement. The bill includes the popular AR-15 rifle under its ban and dozens of other semi-automatic rifles. House Speaker Kevin McCarthy struggles to get 218 votes on his proposal to raise the national debt limit and is uncertain when lawmakers will be able to hold the vote, according to multiple GOP sources. While Republicans haven't yet scheduled the vote, they had made today their informal goal to lock down the votes to push their package through along party lines. Back with more after this. Stay with us. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network. The Todd Allball Show. Time and temperature sign is now 9:15. That's quarter after the hour. Welcome back along Mr. Aaron Zommers, our producer and engineer. Question I'd like to ask a little bit, not a little bit. We'll ask it. The question, who is your favorite local Wisconsin beer brewer? If you are someone that partakes of the hops, who's your favorite brewer?
Now that is a difficult question.
Because there's a lot to choose from, right? A lot to choose from. We're going to talk in just a moment about one of our great brewers in Wisconsin, in Merrill, just outside of Wausau there, just a stone's throw. Sawmill Brewing, winning a big national award. I know Pat Kreitler mentioned it this morning in Up North News. We'll talk about it a little bit more in just a moment. But Sawmill Brewing in Merrill, congratulations to them. Great job on this national award. But who is your favorite Wisconsin local brewer? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. And this could be a little bit of a regional game, right? Because if you live in Amory, you may not know all the breweries down in the southern part of the state. And if you're in Richland Center, you might not be aware of places up north like Sawmill Brewing. And if you're in Wausau, again, you might know about Sawmill, which is fantastic, but you might not know about somebody else. So this is a great way to get to know each other, get to know some other brewery. And again, not every local brewery is going to be available across the state yet, perhaps. Some will. I mean, you've got big ones, right, like New Glarus Brewing down here in southern Wisconsin that makes Spotted Cow. I think most Wisconsinites are familiar with Spotted Cow. Great local brewery. You know what my favorite Spotted Cow, or my favorite Spotted Cow? You know what my favorite New Glarus beer is?
What is it?
I mean, I love the Spotted Cow. Don't get me wrong. They make a strawberry rhubarb beer.
Oh, yeah. Their fruity beers are very unique and to die for. They're so good. They come in packs of four, so they're more expensive.
Right.
And they're very worth it.
They're very worth it. I mean, my grandma Allball used to make the best strawberry rhubarb jam ever. And I've kind of honed down the recipe so I can get it pretty darn close. I'm a big strawberry rhubarb kind of guy. And a few years ago, what I discovered, I think it was my friend Kurt Kohler, who had a bottle of this in his refrigerator down in Monroe. He said, you got to try this. Life-changing.
I got their Door County Cherry Tart, I think it's called, beer one time. And I have some friends who don't like beer. And I was like, you guys should try this. And yes, I'm just going to give you a whole bottle, not the sip of mine. And they're like, are you sure? I'm not going to drink it. And I'm like, no, you're going to drink it. You're going to like it.
All right.
And they did.
And again, to your point, I mean, it's not, you don't want to have a strawberry rhubarb beer with every meal or with every hamburger or whatever, but just sitting out on a deck on a spring day or a summer day, you know, after you worked a little bit, got a little sweaty, maybe a little warm, and you just want to have like a nice, relaxing beer. Oh, strawberry rhubarb from New Glarus. You cannot beat it with a stick. What is your favorite local brewery? Or your favorite local Wisconsin beer? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. Another, unfortunately, no longer with us in the former iteration, but you had Ale Asylum here in Madison for many years. Hopalicious was another favorite beer of mine. And I believe another small brewery here in Wisconsin, in Madison, is bringing Hopalicious back. That is my understanding from a story that I read. They kind of bought the rights or the recipes to some of Ale Asylum's brewers. So Hopalicious is coming back soon to a bar or a grocery store or convenience store near you. So Hopalicious, another one from the former Ale Asylum, was one of my favorites. What is your favorite beer, your favorite brewer? 715-388-7155. We'll have this story on Sawmill Brewing in just a moment. Just want to finish up a couple other news headlines on the what you need to know. Important ones as we go through Sudan. The World Health Organization warned yesterday of a huge biological risk after Sudanese fighters seized the National Public Health Laboratory in Sudan's capital. A high-ranking medical source told CNN and other sources that the lab, which contains samples of diseases and other biological material, had been taken over by Rapid Support Forces, the paramilitary group battling the Sudanese army for control of the country. The World Health Organization did not assign blame to the lab seizure, but said medical technicians no longer held access to the facility. Meanwhile, foreign nations are racing to mount rapid evacuation efforts from the country as violence punctured by fragile U.S.-brokered ceasefire. The 72-hour truce raised hopes of opening up escape routes for civilians, despite desperate to flee. But fighting appears to be raging on as the two warring sides accuse each other of violating an agreement. This is really important because, as we know, there's still debate on exactly how the coronavirus first started out. And now it appears that there may be some validity to the fact that it began in a lab in Wuhan, China. Other people still believe that it was perhaps started in the lab and passed on through animals. We don't know exactly for sure yet. But the point is that for a lab, a biological lab, to no longer be under control of the scientists in Sudan, certainly has dangerous and wide-ranging implications for the world, should that not be retaken and resecured. So we'll be watching that. Salmonella, the USDA is considering changes to limit the amount of salmonella bacteria in some chicken products. More than 1 million people in the U.S. get sick from salmonella each year, according to the CDC, and nearly a quarter of infections are attributed to eating poultry. In many instances, salmonella is caused by poultry products that may look like they've been cooked or browned before freezing, but they're only heat-treated, and they contain raw meats that need to be thoroughly cooked to destroy salmonella, according to the USDA. The agency said that because of how the products appear, it may also be difficult to determine whether they have been cooked enough. Under the new proposed rule, any product that tests positive for salmonella prior to stuffing or breading would not be allowed on store shelves. The bottom line here is, cook your darn chicken. I mean, if you a great product. I eat a lot of chicken, but cook this stuff thoroughly before you consume it. I don't know why you would undercook chicken. Are you a chicken fan, Mr. Summers?
Yeah, but I would not undercook chicken. That's for sure.
You're a thorough chicken cooker.
Yeah, like I enjoy having a medium rare burger or something. But right. chicken is not a meat that you eat raw.
Right. No, I like my steaks. I like my burgers medium rare. Especially a good cut of meat, like a filet.
Absolutely.
I mean, you don't want to overcook a good cut of meat. You lose all the flavor. You lose the tenderness. I agree with you. But no, when it comes to chicken, I'm not eating any pig chicken. That's for sure. Put that back on the grill and grill that bird. You know what goes great with chicken? A good glass of beer, a beverage, a bottle of your favorite beverage. And that's what goes great with it.
You know, we talked about festivals around the state the other day. Yes. And I can't believe I neglected to mention one of my favorite ones.
All right.
Beer Fest.
But where is this at?
This year is the 32nd annual Wisconsin Microbrewers Beer Fest hosted by Rowlands Calumet Brewing Company. So it's in Chilton on May 21st this year. And basically they have a whole bunch of breweries and they all have stations with different taps and you get a commemorative mug and you bring your mug around and you ask for a half or a full glass of whatever beer they have on tap and just try different beer from different places.
It's fantastic.
And go around basically all day doing that.
Have you been to one?
Yeah, I've gone to two so far, the last two, and I'm going to this one for sure.
When is it?
It is May 21st. However, tickets are $45, which considering you get a mug and a lot of beer, very worth it. But no tickets are sold at the door. You have to buy them from the brewery, Rowlands, ahead of time.
Yes.
So if you're not in the Chilton area, that could be a pain. And I don't even know if they have any yet because I forgot to check yet. I'm sure they do. They usually don't sell out a month ahead.
They're great festivals. And again, it's all about being responsible, right? Got to be responsible.
Absolutely. For example, talking about being responsible, if you are a designated driver, you don't have to pay.
Oh, really? Well, fantastic. Have a nice soda or non-alcoholic beverages while you're there. That's great. I had the pleasure of going to the Midwest Beer Festival held here at Olin Park in Madison a couple of different times. And I get a very similar type of event where they have tents and setups and you get a little mug and you go around and you just get a splash. It's not like you go around and you know, drink, you know, glasses of beer. It's just a splash, a taste. But of course, after you get so many tastes,
with this one, you can do full glasses if you want. Some people most definitely do. And you can tell very early on.
You want to get your Lyft or Uber or have a ride available so you're not drinking and driving, certainly. But, you know, it's a great time had by all to sample some of the great craft. Because, again, like winemaking or anything else, it's a craft. And you have to know what you're doing, cooking, whatever it is. So Sawmill Brewing Company up in Merrill, Wisconsin, has won a national competition. This from WAOW News in Wausau, Channel 9 News. Great source here, Merrill, Wisconsin. The votes are in, and Sawmill Brewing Company has taken home the national title in the March Brewsanity Bracket Competition. The Merrill Brewery beat out Common John Brewery Company in Tennessee for the prize. Nice job. Anytime we can beat Tennessee, right? They'll receive an award ceremony, a national champion trophy, and a $1,000 donation to the charity of their choice. Head brewer Ben, I believe it's Osnes, says they are continually blown away by the community's support throughout the contest. Quote, "It still hasn't sunk in for us," he said. "Just the support is amazing. We just all feel the love. And again, all the celebration we're doing, we're sharing it with everybody. This is everyone's title. The owners have yet to decide which charity to donate to, and we'll hold a vote on social media where fans can decide which local charity will receive the donation." Again, congratulations to Sawmill Brewing Company winning the national competition for best beer, beating out Tennessee. That's fantastic. Who is your favorite brewer? 715-388-7155. Again, 715-388-7155. Go to the lines. Well, we had somebody on the line there, and the call was dropped. So if you were on the line, give us a call back. Sorry about that. We'd love to hear from you. Again, 715-388-7155. What is your favorite brewery? What is your favorite brew? That is what we are asking. Again, whoever was on the line there, give us a call back. Sorry we dropped the call there accidentally. We'll have you back on if you call back. Look, like your calls as well, 715-388-7155. Who's your favorite brewery? What is your favorite brew in terms of beer? We'll come back after this and talk more. This is the Todd Hallball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.
Digging deep holes, I'm not made for paving long roads. I ain't cut out to climb high line poles, but I'm pretty good at drinking beer.
Welcome back to the Todd Hallball Show, 9:33. Great song for the topic. Who we got there on the music this morning, Mr. Summers?
Billy Currington, and you'll never guess the title of the song.
Tell us, please.
Pretty good. And drinking beer.
Like that. Pretty good at drinking beer. I remember Billy Currington when his voice was not that low. He's been around a while. He started as kind of a child singer and gone on from there. So, yeah, well, you know, and again, we're not trying to sit here and say, I think there's a real difference, right, in talking about beer as a fine product, especially craft beer. That's very different from just drinking beer to get drunk when you're in college or any other time. So we're not here to promote, you know, over-excessive drinking, but it's like wine, right? And the thing is, and we've talked about this before, one of the great things about having international student programs, whether they're high school or whether they're college, is when you host people, particularly from European countries or even pretty much any other country, you know, it's not a socially unacceptable thing for someone to have a glass of alcoholic beverage, whether it's wine or a beer, whatever. It's ingrained at a very early age that it's very uncouth to get drunk. That you don't drink beer to get drunk in Germany. You drink it as a fine product that you have with a meal, one glass. Same thing with wine.
Right.
And so that's the kind of, you know, and it's certainly part of Wisconsin's heritage with all the German heritage and Bavarian heritage, Austrian heritage in Wisconsin, that beer is a huge part of our Wisconsin history, especially from Milwaukee.
Much like Todd, I enjoy a good beverage. And right? I like to drink a lot of water. Like, I actually like water. Some people don't. But beer and wine and stuff like that, I think it's pretty much undeniable that alcoholic beverages are the ones that get the most care and research into developing them and making them better.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, they're not continually trying to research Coke or Pepsi or Mountain Dew or whatever. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, Coke tried to do a new Coke, right, years and years ago. It didn't take off so well.
And whenever they do other, like, novelty flavors, they're just that. They're novelty flavors. And I've tried some of those now and then. Not great.
Right.
You ever had, I can't remember exactly what it was, if it was, like, Red Hot Mountain Dew.
Oh,
or no, it was Flamin' Hot, like Flamin' Hot Cheetos crossover with Mountain Dew.
Oh my gosh.
I tried a sip of somebody's and I was like, this is just bad. It's just Mountain Dew that tastes not quite right and hurts your mouth.
Ugh. I can you imagine the chemicals in that?
It tastes like it.
I mean, just the amount of ugh.
Like Flamin' Hot Cheetos, sure. Mountain Dew, sure. Flamin' Hot Mountain Dew, hell no.
it's just not going to happen. Not going to happen. So yes, what we're talking about here, asking what your favorite brew is in Wisconsin. What's your favorite beer? What's your favorite brewmaster? What's your favorite brewery in Wisconsin? 715-388-7155. Again, the number to call, 715-388-7155. I'm a fan of New Glarus. Like I say, I like Spotted Cow. I like the strawberry rhubarb. Locally here in Madison, the Great Dane, the Crop Circle Wheat. I'm a fan of that. The aforementioned Ale Asylum and Hopalicious. Certainly a fan of that. But give us a call. Tell us what your local beer is. Well, this is all prompted by Sawmill Brewing in Merrill, Wisconsin, winning a national competition, beating out Tennessee for best beer in this national competition. Congratulations to Sawmill Brewing. up in Merrill, Wisconsin, just northwest of the great city of Wausau. Give us a call. Let us know what your favorite brew is. 715-388-7155. What goes great with beer, but sports, of course, and the Green Bay Packers? Mentioned this earlier. And I know Pat Kreitlow earlier this morning talked a little bit about this as well. And I do think it's good to stop and pause and reflect and recognize this. Aaron Rodgers, after being traded officially to the New York Jets yesterday, Aaron Rodgers put out on Instagram basically a farewell letter. And whatever you want to say about the guy, whether he wrote all this or whether it was his agent, who the heck knows. But I think it is proper to at least acknowledge the way that Aaron Rodgers is leaving Green Bay. Because I don't remember Brett Favre doing something quite as gracious when he went to the Jets. So I'm going to read this to you. If you haven't seen it, if you don't have Instagram, here's what Aaron Rodgers said yesterday, last night, about leaving Green Bay. He starts off by saying thank you, and then has a heart emoji. He says, quote, "I'm not sure it's possible to fully express the gratitude that I have to the Packers, our incredible fans, and the state of Wisconsin. The thousands of players that I crossed paths with the incredible men and women who work for the organization and the amazing people who I got to meet along the way in one post with 10 pictures. But I hope when you read this and feel my heart and soul filled with love, joy, and peace about the time I spent in green and gold," that he has a green heart and a gold heart. Aaron Rodgers says, "I grew up in Green Bay, drafted," and Kreitlow mentioned this as well, and I agree. Not that, you know, he was born and raised in California. But what he meant is, you know, at 21, you still got some growing up to do in terms of becoming a mature adult and organizing your opinion. So Aaron Rodgers said, "I grew up in Green Bay, drafted at 21, fell in love with the game, met some lifelong friends, and take with me memories that will last a lifetime. I'm grateful to the late Ted Thompson for drafting me for my head coaches, especially the 13 years with Mike McCarthy and the last 4 years with Matt LaFleur. I had some incredible men to work with in the QB room over the years, including Tom, AVP, Luke, and Connor. Huge thank you to my guys in the equipment room, Red, T-Bone, Odea, Kev, Brian, Andy Grober, all my dear friends in the training room over the years, Nate, Flea, Doc McKenzie, Doc Gray, Pep, and Cuz. The legendary Adam Corzine and his incredible staff, Dougie, Krabby, and Scotty, were always looking out for me. Nate, Tom, Sarah, and Jason in PR. Evan for bringing my work life to film. The Rock and Wayne for giving words to the highlights of my career. Gray and Big Rob for your work with the guys over the years. Bloke, Thad, Grant, Giz in the weight room. Bob Harlan, Russ Ball, Mark Murphy, and Brian Gutekunst for your stewardship of the organization." So that's nice. He called out Mark Murphy and then Brian Gutekunst. "Every one of the third and fourth floor who make that building run smoothly, and so many countless others at the loading dock, tours, concessions, maintenance, our field crew, etc. To the fans," Aaron Rodgers says in capital letters, "thank you. You made every run out of the tunnel special, every home game magical. It was my honor to be your QB. To my teammates, I love you all. I'm thankful for the moments on and off the field that brought us close. I played with legends. I played with friends. Thanks for believing in me and having my back always." Puts a heart. "This is not the end for us. I will see you again, Green Bay. You'll always have my heart. Signed, 12. Hashtag grateful. Hashtag 18 years. Hashtag green and gold." So there you go. That's the official goodbye from Aaron Rodgers. And again, whether or not he wrote all that, I think he's a smart dude. So nothing here says that was not him writing it to me. I think it was probably earnest. I think it was him. And again, certainly a classy way to leave Green Bay.
I was glad to hear this or see this statement. I guess hear it because I heard it from you and from Pat. But because it reminds us that he is a person. He's not just a whack job. It's easy for us to dehumanize celebrities.
Mm. No, I agree. I think that, look, you can't, whatever you want to say about Aaron Rodgers, he's not a dumb person. He's very, very intelligent. And I think that's one of the things that looking back on his time at Green Bay, I think that's sometimes why people, you know, said, well, he's kind of a jerk or he's kind of egotistical, whatever. To a degree, maybe he was, but I think that anybody who is that successful at that level, you have to have some ego about you, whether it's politics, whether it's sports, whether it's business. In order to be successful at a state national level, usually there's some amount of ego associated with the person. I think that Aaron Rodgers probably spent more time looking at film, studying, and knowing the opponent better than anybody else in the Packers organization. And I think that's why he didn't suffer fools gladly. He didn't enjoy new young receivers who didn't put the same amount of time into the prep that he did. He didn't appreciate and enjoy coaches who didn't put the same amount of time and prep that he did. He made a lot of money, but I truly believe that each and every week Aaron Rodgers put in the homework to try to make them successful. And maybe there were times, to be fair, maybe there were times when he knew or thought he knew more than the coaches, and so that's why he didn't want to go along with the game plan. I think particularly in his later career when newer coaches were brought in and trying to say, well, Aaron, we're going to do it this way. And he's like, look, I've been here for 15, 16 years. I know what these guys are going to do. And so that's why he went his own route. And I think that frustrated a lot of people in management and coaching staff between them and Aaron Rodgers. So the guy was incredibly smart. He is incredibly smart. You can't deny that. And I don't know what goes on in his personal life. And, you know, it's none of our business, right? To me, he seems like someone who has a lot eating at him, that he has a lot going on personally inside of his own personal life that he needs to deal with. And I think it's unfortunate that he feels perhaps that he can't deal with that publicly. I wish that Aaron Rodgers could truly be his real self, if that's what's going on in his life. And so I think that's what part of this whole thing is, him kind of like the goofiness, some people would call it, and kind of the off-the-wallness over the last 2 or 3 years. I don't know. Maybe the guy's struggling. I wish him well. He certainly gave Green Bay all that he could during his 18 years in Titletown. Won a Super Bowl. Certainly should have been back at multiple Super Bowls. And a lot of that was not his fault. I mean, the game I keep going back to is the NFC Championship game in Seattle with Russell Wilson on the other side. The Packers had no business losing that game. They should have gone on to the Super Bowl. They should have won the Super Bowl. Aaron Rodgers should have had 2 titles. But, I mean, that ridiculous last 2 or 3 minutes of that NFC title game in Seattle, where Seattle came down from whatever it was, 2 touchdowns or 2 touchdowns and a field goal, whatever it was. I've tried to block it out of my mind. But that was certainly one that was winnable, that had almost nothing to do with Aaron Rodgers. And the Packers blew that one. You know, a couple seasons ago against Tom Brady, had Tom Brady at home in the NFC title game. Packers should have won that one. So I don't think you can point the finger all at Aaron Rodgers and say, you know, the what-ifs and the close games were all his fault. There are a lot of other things going on. What's your thought? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. What's your favorite beer? What's your favorite brewery in Wisconsin? What are your thoughts on Aaron Rodgers going to the Jets? What do you think of this goodbye letter, this goodbye note that he's penned? I got to say, I was impressed until I heard about it. I'm like, well, it's probably something an agent or a publicist wrote. And then I read it. I'm like, you know, that's probably legit. That was probably actually him. That seems pretty authentic to the kind of guy that he is. You know, a lot of Pat McAfee and other shows that, you know, I think in his own way, he tries to do well by others. Last couple of years, a little goofy, but he tries to do well. And you know what? I wish him success in New York. I said this yesterday with Luke Mathers. This coming year, assuming that people are healthy, I expect the Jets to go further than Green Bay in terms of playoffs and that sort of thing. And that's not to beat up on Jordan Love. I wish him all the success, and I want the Packers to do well. I just think, I mean, with a new quarterback, new people coming in, it's going to take time for that whole thing to gel. I hope I'm proven wrong. Would love to see the Packers go to the Super Bowl in year one with Jordan Love.
Now that would be something.
That would be something. I just don't see it happening. We're going to talk on Friday. Brady Ewing on. Lots to talk about with Brady this week on our 8:30 segment. We'll be talking about the Packers, talking about Rodgers, talking about the Badgers, the launch, their game last week as well. Back with more after this. This is the Todd Allball Show on Civic Media's Radio Network.
I'm pretty good at drinking beer.
Show it is 9:50 on the time and temperature side. We'll jump around there. Mentioned the launch happening last weekend at Camp Randall Stadium over the weekend. The big unveiling of Phil Longo's air raid offense for the Wisconsin Badgers and new head coach Luke Fickell. A lot of hype. A lot of hype. And granted, I was thinking about it. We went to the Mr. Zomers and Pat Kreitlow and Terry Bell and Luke Mathers and I went down to the Brewers last Friday. And again, when we give these Brewer tickets away, call in because they're fantastic seats, club level seats. They're not your average seat. All right. So make sure you call in when we give them away. Anyway, we went to the game on Friday, and then Saturday was the launch, the spring kind of open scrimmage practice game. And had thought about going, but it was kind of rainy and snowy and crappy weather. And I just said, I ended up doing some cleaning around the apartment, so stayed inside. But read about it, followed on Twitter, read about it, and may have come a little bit, maybe the whole hype was a little bit premature because the defense apparently was fantastic, but the offense struggled a little bit, particularly the quarterback position, which, of course, we all heard how these new quarterbacks are going to be fantastic. So, you know, look, much too early to hit the panic button, but I think the point is, you know, let's just dial back. You know, a lot of people are, you know, talking, you know, playoff contenders for the Badgers this fall. Maybe a little premature on that, but we'll see. Still a lot of time left on the Badgers. Again, we'll talk more about that with Brady Ewing on Friday morning at 8:30. We'll finish up this kind of sports and beer hour. I didn't really necessarily plan it that way this morning, but it just kind of worked out that way. And that's fine. Sometimes that's where you got to go. But if you still want to call in and talk about your favorite local brewery, this is all precipitated this morning by the news that Sawmill Brewing in Merrill, Wisconsin, just northwest of Wausau, has won a national beer competition, beating out Tennessee, a brewery in Tennessee. So congratulations to Sawmill Brewing in Merrill, Wisconsin. What is your favorite brewery? What is your favorite beer? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. Anyway, we've rounded out a little sports and beer talk this hour with the Milwaukee Bucks. Of course, Mr. Mathers' favorite team, or the biggest Bucks fan, I would say, in Civic Media, Luke Mathers. By the way, you can hear Luke Mathers every afternoon from 2 until 3 on the Civic Media Radio Network, along with Mr. Brian Kelly on Dueling Tangents at 2 o'clock. Except for in Wausau, where our other great friend, Chad Holmes, has the Chad Holmes Show from 2 until 4 on WXCO Bull Falls Radio. Both programs available on the Civic Media app. If you don't have it, what the heck? Come on now. Download that puppy. Go to your favorite app store on your smartphone. Type in Civic, C-I-V-I-C, as in Civics class, Civic Media. The logo will come up. It's a C and an M for Civic Media. Hit download. It's free. It's a deal. It takes less than a minute to download it. Then open it up. On the left-hand side of your phone screen, hit Other Stations. Other Stations. Then scroll down to WRCE. news from the center, in Richland Center, our hometown station, WRCE. Click on that. You can listen to Mr. Zommers and I each and every day from 8 until 11, Monday through Friday. You can listen to other great shows like Phil Knees, Sunrise from the Center, from 6 until 8. And, of course, you can hear Julian Tangents with Luke and Brian from 2 until 3. And then if you go up to Bull Falls Radio at 2 o'clock, you can tune into the Chad Holmes Show with Chad Holmes. So all those available on the Civic Media app. Anyway, the Milwaukee Bucks, they are trailing 3-1 in their first round playoff series against the Miami Heat. Tonight's home game is one of the more critical in franchise history. You might say, well, that's a lot of puff, Todd. That's a lot of puff. We'll see. Milwaukee is number one playoff seed in this conference. Miami is number 8. 1-8. Top seeds are not supposed to go down like this, not with so many championship expectations. A defeat tonight could well send the franchise off in a new direction. A victory, as Jesse Jackson likes to say, keeps hope alive. Keep hope alive. One of my favorite political speeches of all time. Jesse Jackson at the 1988 Democratic Convention. Keep hope alive. We're going to go to Appleton right now. 715-388-7155 is the number to call. Be like Jim. Jim in Appleton. Good morning. How are you, sir?
Good morning, Todd. I'm doing well. How about yourself?
Well, it's beautiful and sunny down here in Madison. Cannot complain. What is on your mind this morning?
Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll kind of miss him, but I have the definite feeling that he overstayed his welcome.
Sure.
He got to where he was calling a lot of his own plays, and when they worked, great. But when they didn't, you could see it in the coaching staff. It's, what's he doing now?
Right.
And this goes back to McCarthy.
Right. But no, I raised the question, agree or disagree. I think that no one studied harder for a game against opposition than Aaron Rodgers. I think he got frustrated, right or wrong, when he felt that either his fellow players or his coaches weren't as informed of him as he was, and that's when he kind of went off on his own. Agree or disagree?
I can't agree with that.
Okay, very good. That's fine.
There have been other great players. Woodson, for one.
Sure.
Who virtually lived in the film room.
Yep.
Aaron spent a lot of time there, yeah, and he did study a lot, but you go back to that Seattle debacle?
Yes.
Yeah, it was a debacle. Yeah, it was a lot of coaching errors, but let's not forget that Aaron ran two or three and outs.
Yeah.
Well, Seattle was racing up that score, and every one of the plays he called, all six of those plays he called were his own plays.
Yeah,
so he does have a little culpability in that mess, too.
You're probably right. It's just, I just remember watching that game thinking that this cannot happen. This cannot be true. And it just like seems like every statistical thing that could go wrong in that game in the last 5 minutes did. I mean, there's no way that Seattle should have won that game.
None at all. I absolutely agree with you. Lots of coaching errors, lots of mistakes. Aaron shared in the mistakes.
Sure, he shared it. I mean, I think about the guy they let go right after that game. The guy on the special teams that ended up catching or was supposed to catch the kickoff. You know,
I was supposed to leave the onside kick alone.
Right,
yeah.
I mean, just like Judas Priest. I mean, really. I mean, that was just like, what the heck?
Yeah, that's all him.
So what do you think?
You can see the coaches on the sidelines. No.
Right.
Well,
so I've got just a couple of 10 seconds. Packers, do they make the playoffs this year with Jordan Love?
It's way too early for me to make a prediction like that.
All right, Jim. Thanks for staying with us. We appreciate it. Jim and Appleton back with more after this. This is the Todd Allball Show in Civic Media.